So I ordered several items from the future was 8-bit quite a while ago. Haven't done anything with it, and one of the items that I purchased was I can see a couple of things in there, but one of them was this Atari 2600 or 7800 composite mod. Now, one of the reasons I didn't do anything with it is because the instructions are pretty rough. But I think I can probably figure it out. And what I do like about this one is it looks like the installation is probably relatively simple because it just has these four wires that you plug into your motherboard. And it's got this little plug here. And inside here is the actual little board that has the proper electronics on it. Not much to it. You can see, once I wire this up, I just plug it into the board, and then I've got this AV cable that I can plug into the board and then run it outside of the Atari. Now, I think I'm going to do this on the 2600 because I want it to do maybe S video on the 7800. And I think there's some kits available for that. I don't see any need to do S video on the 2600. So we'll just do that. The other reason is because the 2600 has this cable running out, and this would work really nicely with this AV cable instead of using an RF. I just run AV out. So I think that'll work nice. With that, why don't we go ahead and take this 2600 apart and see what we've got inside of here. So here's my motherboard taken right straight out of the Atari. And you can see this is a Rev-12 board, I believe. Yeah, it says Rev-12, copyright 1980. So not the newest, not the oldest. Your standard four switch model. So I've got the difficulty switches in the back. Here's my channel select. This will go away. I've already removed the RF cable from here. I do want to, I have to remove the shielding, the RF shielding. That shouldn't be too hard. And then we'll take a look at the inside. I do know that this will end up coming off, and there's a couple other little components in here that come off. And yeah, let's go ahead and get started with that. So here's my board. The instructions that I've seen so far call for removing the RF box here, this transformer or whatever you call it. And also, this guy will come out and this guy will come out. And then there's going to be a slight little mod in this area as well. All right, let's use my extremely cheap Radio Shack desoldering iron and see if I can desolder this. Now, I guess one trick with desoldering is to reflow the solder with fresh solder. Now, I don't know. I'm going to just try to see if I can apply enough heat to this to get it to work. Probably isn't going to work. I probably have to get regular soldering iron out. Yeah, let me get a regular soldering iron and see if I can get that hot enough. Set it on there. See if it'll heat up enough to remove. Oh, there you go. Looking nice. Take this one now. Not bad. Think that'll work. Let's try this one over here. This is kind of convenient. It's a solder sucker, but it heats up at the tip, so I can keep it hot. It's not as effective as a soldering iron to get the temperature up, but it's hot enough to keep it melted. Let's look at how this side over here. So I also want to get these guys off. Nice thing here is I don't have to worry about damaging any of these components because they're all coming off permanently. There we go. Sounds like a little kid sucking sucking snot back up his nose. Let's see if this will come off now. Give it a little pull. Nope, it's not coming off. A little bit. It's really on there. Best bet might be just to try to snip these things off. Maybe apply heat to it while I'm prying on it. I don't have any way to hold on to the board. I'm prying. I don't want to burn myself. There, guts off. Let's try this side. So a little bit of solder just kind of sticking on there. There we go. That's off. And now this one. This one's got quite a bit of solder stuck in there. There we go. And now we'll do each one of these individually till the whole thing comes off. Starting to come off. Come on, just two left. Let's go. There we go. That's one RF modulator off the Atari. Okay, next step is I got to get this RF tuner, I believe that's what this is, it's a tuner, off the board. And I just need to make sure I'm grabbing the right components because I don't want to take the wrong thing off. But it looks like it's going to be this one here. Let's go ahead and heat this up. And the one next to it, let's heat this one up. I'm going to use my solder sucker again because that seemed to work pretty good. I think the solder on here it's pretty old. Looks like this board may have been reflown at one time. Possibly it was repaired. Don't think my solder sucker is doing me any good, so let me just pull it from the back. Yeah, there we go. It's out. And I'll try this side here. Oh boy, I can't tell where that's hooked in. Should be right here. Let's try it. There we go. That's it. Come on, come on. It's got, oh jeepers, look at that. She's melting. I'm melting. There we go, perfect. So it's a little tricky. I need to remove this guy. It's a little tricky to find out exactly where it's at when I flip it over. And I don't want to remove the wrong component. So I think what I'm going to do is just snip it off. So as high as I can, just snip it. And that's going to make it a little easier now to just heat these up and pop them off one by one. There we go. So I have to pop off R209. This is the NTSC board, so there's a little bit less work to do than the PAL board. But I'm just going to grab it here and see if I can just pry it up. There we go. Okay, so I've got the components removed that I needed to take off, and this resistor R209. Now I need to wire in my leads, and white goes the third row over right underneath this guy, and then it goes to the black, and then I skip a space, and then I believe goes to red and then yellow. So this should be pretty easy to get in there. There we go. Should be in there. That's a really long cable. I don't know if I want that. I think I'm going to trim these up a little bit because that's just ridiculously long. I just need to plug it in here, and that's like miles of cable. So let me pop this guy off and shorten it up a little bit. do some snipping. I'm going to leave it a little bit longer. I'm afraid if I don't want to cut it too short. There, that's a lot of extra wire. And I have a wire stripper someplace in the garage, but let me see if I can do this without the wire strippers. Depending on how much wire is left in here. Come on. Could probably do this better with my pocket knife. There we go. There's a little bit of wire. So I've got my Atari all put back together. Here's the extra parts that came out of it. And I've got my game here, Frogger. So let's go ahead and plug it in and see what happens when I turn it on. That's very nice. So we have a nice picture. There's some unusual banding, some bars going on, and a little bit of noise. So I'm not exactly sure what's going on there. And we've got a tiny bit of ghosting as well. Not an absolutely perfect picture, but not terrible either. To be honest with you, I'm not sure I'm really getting any better picture out of this than I am out of the RF. But we'll also compare this to the RF. So here's a picture of the Atari with the RF out. It is surprisingly good. You can zoom right in and see the pixel detail. It looks just fantastic. There's really hardly any noise. It's a little soft. That's the one thing I'll notice is it's a little soft, but it really does look nice. So if you have a television that can tune to channel 3, the old NTSC, I would say RF really is the way to go with these old Ataris. But if you have a television and composite is the only way you can get a picture, then of course you're going to need to do a conversion on an old Atari 2600. So a couple of things to note. If you decide to do a conversion on your Atari, depending on the board you've got, it's going to be depend on how fragile it is. Like this is a revision 14 board, and I find that it's very fragile. Like the pads like to lift on this. Another thing is you're going to have to solder it on both sides. So you can see I've got a lead right at the it's the second one over. I'm gonna zoom in a little bit. This one actually started to lift a little bit, so this is going to be a little tricky to get this one to work properly in the future. And over here on this side of the board, I'm just totally unimpressed with this board. You've got your connections over here, and this is where you're gonna have to solder into. Now these kind of almost are like a foil. It's like a foil that's glued on there. So it's very, very easy to damage these boards. So I would say, you know, if you're gonna do this, definitely proceed with caution. And also keep in mind that you're gonna have to solder on both sides so that you can get connection through, making sure you got a good connection through all the wires. So yeah, in conclusion, I would say that if you have a television that tunes to channel 3, the analog signal, or you know, on PAL land, it's gonna be a different station. But as long as you have the analog tuner built in your television, I don't really see a need to convert this to composite. But if you have a television, and more TVs now are not able to tune to channel 3, That's where you're going to need to convert to composite. But even then, that doesn't guarantee forward compatibility, because you still have to worry about even having a composite input, because a lot of televisions don't even have that. So that's where you're going to need to look at something like a RetroTINK. So you actually convert your Atari to composite, and then from composite to HDMI. That can get a little expensive. So that's all I have for this video. If you enjoyed it and you haven't done so already, please consider subscribing. It's going to help this channel a lot, help me grow, and be able to bring you more wonderful content in the future. I'll see you in the next video, and until then, take care of yourself and goodbye.